Spirit, come afresh on me. Fill me with your power.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. And for those of you that are watching online, welcome to worship. This is Christ Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Mark Groves, and we're really happy that you're here. I should just like take off my shirt and put some tribal tattoos on or something like that. It would not be a pretty thing, I promise. Although I don't care, they're mine and I'm keeping them. Anyway, it's good to have you here this morning. It's interesting. In a congregation, after a while, people get to know you well enough and trust you that they'll call you or text you to tell you that they're not going to be in church. And I don't know if that's a guilt thing. I'm going with it, though. I had several calls, lots of stuff going on as summer begins. Speaking of summer, don't you love the weather? This is awesome. I love this heat, man. I spend all day outside, and I don't have to dig a ditch or anything like that, but I'm just sitting out there in the weather, and it's nice. I have two fans on my patio, yeah, it's nice there. Anyway, this is Holy Trinity Sunday, and we're going to talk some about that and what that means a little bit without going too far down that rabbit hole. But before we begin, I did want to say, isn't that spectacular? Isn't that wonderful? We want to thank those who made it. They're sitting over there. We are blessed with many gifts here, and that certainly is one of them. Creativity is one of them, and we're going to talk about that too. So as you're able, we're going to begin our service today with our affirmation using the words of the Nicene Creed. And so we say together with one voice, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We gather this morning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A wind from God blew over the face of the waters.
And the voice of God spoke.
Jesus breathed peace on his disciples.
And the Spirit of God rested on all gathered.
God's Spirit still moves among us. Come, Holy Spirit, come and fill us in this place. United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, for creation, and for all in need. Please pray with me. O one God, giver of life, you established peace through your Son and gave your church the hope of sharing your glory. Call us by your Spirit to speak and act in love for the sake of the world. Lord, in your mercy, Creator of all, you rejoice in creation and have given humankind responsibility for the works of your hands. Instill in everyone your spirit of care for the earth, especially in those places devastated by extreme and violent weather, and those places where the balance of nature is threatened by changing climate. Lord, in your mercy, loving Redeemer, you delighted in the human race and gifted us with the freedom of will. Move the hearts of leaders of nations and those with influence to seek wisdom, speak truth, and care for all people, regardless of their state or station. We pray for our president and all elected leaders, for those who respond to our crisis, for those who fight our fires and who keep us safe from crime, as well as those who work for peace in the world. Oh God, we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine. Bless and comfort those who live in fear, those who are separated from families and homes, those who are injured and those who grieve. Lord, in your mercy, abiding comforter, you call out to all who live. Restore severed relationships. Protect children who are neglected and threatened. Grant hope to those who are experiencing fear and pain or grief, as well as those concerns that we offer at this time. Lord, in your mercy, God of wonder, watch over the scouts of 577 during the coming week as they embark on their camping adventure. Encourage and give patience to those who would lead them. Give them eyes to see you in all of creation and in the learning that they do. Be with us during our upcoming vacation Bible school. Bless those young people who will gather here and those who will lead them, that they will have ears to hear the good news of your love for them and how that is the treasure that you give them. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, we remember your saints for their strong faith and witness even unto death. Console grieving families, stir up in us resolve to end sin and pursue courageous path of justice. Lord, in your mercy. God of every time and place, in Jesus' name, you filled us with your Spirit, and we entrust these spoken prayers to you in our hearts and into your holy keeping. We ask all these things and whatever else you see that we need in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our risen Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me turn off my ringer. I'm always worried somebody's going to call me. Would you pray with me one more time, please? Oh, gracious God, we ask that you gather us in this morning. Grant us your Spirit in this place so that we might have ears to hear and willing hearts to listen, that we might be made new and make your kingdom real in this place. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So I'm going to read this morning from the Gospel of John, the 16th chapter. And by the way, this is like one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. Jesus is talking to his disciples just before he leaves them, and he says, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you in all truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears. And he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me because he will take what is mine and declare to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The word of the Lord. So I actually had to borrow this from my wife. I have $20 here. I have $20 here for anyone who can explain to me the Holy Trinity in a way that leaves me or anyone else in the room without any question. Any takers? I didn't think so. This is the week in the church calendar where we are pointed towards the Trinity, or the unity of the Trinity, or the Holy Trinity, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, three persons, one God, three essence, spirits, whatever gets your head around it, I guess. It's just not an easy topic. You know, over the years, I've, like probably most church leaders, you try to find some analogy to try to explain the Trinity, right? So one is water and ice and steam. It seems to make sense, but it's really not a good analogy because when you freeze water or vaporize it, it changes its composition, right? I had this idea once that particle board would be a good example. You know, particle board is that board that we use for subflooring in houses. And it's a bunch of chunks of wood that are bonded together in such a way that you could never separate them. And if you really let yourself go and ponder this for a while, it's not a bad analogy, except most people don't know what particle board is. And it's kind of boring. And, you know, try to explain particle board to a bunch of 13-year-olds and see what response you get, right? You know? There are other attempts that have been made. I kind of like the idea of the Trinity being three dancing images, dancing in one dance in unison. I don't know. I just don't think I've ever heard an analogy that leaves me without more questions. It's hard to explain, much less understand. You see, there are a few places in the scriptures where we do find the Trinity present, but the Bible itself doesn't use the word Trinity. It doesn't speak of Trinity. It doesn't doctrine of the Trinity. It really wasn't until the 4th century, about 300 years after Jesus' ministry, and after Christianity had grown throughout the world that as we knew it at that time, that Christian leaders gathered together for what was called the Council of Nicaea in 325 CE. And they established the concept of the Trinity as something that is sanctified or a holy teaching of the Scriptures. And lots of things happened as a result of that council, but the one that we know is the Nicene Creed, which we just shared, confessed together. And you should know that the Nicene Creed is probably the most comprehensive explanation of Christian faith that there is. But the Trinity, even as we understand it today, century later, is really a matter of faith. We believe it so because of what the Bible teaches about it and because it has become a tradition within Christendom to help explain the relationship between God and God's people. In other words, we believe it so because we believe it is. So I'm not going to try to explain to you this morning the theological implications of the Trinity or the biblical rationale. Let's just agree that it is a mystery that's revealed through the Scriptures. It's a belief in something that we cannot see or know. In other words, it is a matter of faith. But instead, I wanted to use this passage from the Gospel of John to point you towards the wonder of God's presence in our lives and in the world, one God revealed to us through the Trinity. So I want to begin by reminding you that the Trinity teaches us that our belief in God comes within and through Jesus Christ, and it's the Spirit of God that gets us there, that gives us faith, that gives us the willingness to know God, to know Christ within us. You see, we believe, and here's the easy way to put it, we believe in God in and through Jesus Christ by God's Holy Spirit. That's the system that we use. Now, that's all good to know, but here's my favorite thing about this passage that I read this morning, about what Jesus is saying, and it's the very first thing that we read. He says that there's still a lot that you need to know and learn if you're going to make my presence true, my kingdom come in the world, but you're just not ready to hear it yet. I love that. I love the way that Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he's telling his disciples and us that this whole creation thing, the presence of God in the world, isn't a one and done thing. If you believe that God created all that was and is and will be, well, then you have to believe that God not only created, but continues to create. God continues to reveal to us what already is. And the only way that it comes to us, whether you believe it or not, is by God's Spirit. And it's true whether you believe this is true or not. God's presence and love in the world isn't dependent on one's belief. That's faith. God is already in the world, regardless of whether you or others believe it to be true. But to believe that it's true is to have faith. And faith means that we're willing to see and to recognize God's Spirit working in the world. And then we point to it for God's glory. And here's the thing. It's always here. It's always around us. And the part that we're not ready to hear yet, well, I think that it comes to us over and over again. Over the centuries, we've been able to see it with new eyes, willing eyes, in so many, many different ways. Maybe I could put it another way. And if you'll allow me, I'm going to channel my brother Charlie Heller for a little while. You are made up of atoms. Roughly 7 billion atoms. And to give you an idea about the size of an atom, there are more atoms in a glass of water than there are glasses of water in all the oceans of the earth. Let me repeat that. There are more atoms in a glass of water than there are in all than there are glasses of water in all the oceans of the earth. Now, atoms make up molecules, and molecules make up cells, and cells make up systems in humankind, especially. We have the vascular system and the muscular system and the nervous system, for instance. Now, atoms, we now know, are made up themselves made up of particles. We call them subatomic particles. And we have discovered that they are made up of smaller particles, and those particles are made up of even smaller particles. And in the last 100 years, we've been able to discover that we can split those smallest of particles only to discover more particles. And when you get down to this size, what is known as quantum physics, thank you, brother, it gets a little weird. For instance, they have discovered particles that just suddenly appear, just suddenly come into existence. They don't know where they come from. They just all of a sudden appear. They've discovered one particle that can be in two different places at the same time. They've discovered a particle that can move from point A to point B without traveling the distance between those two. I know this sounds a little strange, but listen to this. Those atoms of ours that are made up of all of those swirling particles of energy are 99.9% empty space. Out of all, scientists have determined that if we took all of the empty space out of all the atoms in the universe, the universe could fit into the size of a sugar cube. I got the same stare Wednesday night. Now, here's something. Some of the atoms that make up you haven't always been you. Prior to you, some of the atoms that make up you also made up other things. Some of the atoms that now make you were used to make something or even someone else. Currently, they make up you, and they will go on to make something or someone else. And we know that the human body sheds some of its cells. It sheds its skin, its integument, and makes new cells. So you get new skin, new outer layer of skin about every month or so. And yet every cell in your body is replaced about every 7 years. Every 7 years, you get a new you. And this happens because about 300 million of your cells die every minute, while at the same time, your body is producing new cells that inexplicably somehow know how to be you. So I came here a little over 9.5 years ago. And the me that you met then has been replaced by an entirely new me, and yet I'm still me. You know, as we learn these things about ourselves, it seems a wonder. It seems a mystery. Quantum physicists will tell you that at this level of particle activity, you have to be able to accept the strange and unexplainable. Think about that for a minute. What happens when you get to a place where you have to believe in that which you cannot see or understand or explain? Well, I had a professor in seminary. I had a professor in seminary that was a quantum physicist before he became a professor of theology. And you'd be surprised at how many scientists become theologians, because when they get to that place of wonder, where the only explanation to the mystery of life and creation is the hand of God. Is this what Jesus was talking about when he said there's more for us to know? You see, we're always changing, and yet there is a continuity in the basic elements that make up all of life and earth, all of creation. All of creation is made up or pretty much shares the same elements. You, so then, are a highly sophisticated and organized system of water and air and what the scriptures calls, says when it says that you are dust. That's carbon. In other words, you are made up of dust, the same dust that makes up the stars. And as true as all of this is, that's not all that we are. That is not all that we are. Because we can hear and take in this information and take it and reflect on it. Unlike a tree, we have a consciousness. We can feel and we can think and know and choose happy or sad and all of the other emotions that we experience. There is the physical, that which we know and can be measured and calculated. And there is the metaphysical or motive knowing, that which is unique to you and makes up what some might call your heart or your soul or your spirit. That which creates in us the ability to love and to hurt, that gives us creativity and intellect and wonder. I mean, with all that we know about the nature of creation and the human body, if we were to crack open the systems in your body, and then the cells, and then the particles that make up the physical you, where would we find love? Where would we find your hurt? Where would we find joy? So there is that which is known or measurable and that which has meaning. And if we were to think of it in this way, we discover that we are all one thing. And yet we are all different, each in our own way. It's that one thing that we're all humans who share this planet and are made up of the same things, needing the same things for life that connect us to one another, and yet we're all connected by that which we cannot measure or calculate. Love, despair, curiosity, creativity. We all have fingers and toes and opposable thumbs, and we can know joy and anger. You see, we're not only connected by what we are, but we are connected by who we are. And I would go on to say that we are connected by whose we are. Which again begs the question, is this what Jesus was talking about when he said there's more that you need to know, but you're really not ready to hear it yet? I mean, think about this. Just in the past 100 years or so, humankind has created the vacuum cleaner, the airplane, and the pop-up toaster and color television. We've created antibiotics, jet engines, the electron microscope, nuclear power, computers, and the ballpoint pen. We've walked on the moon and we've made our way to Mars and made space travel commonplace. And as much as we can point to science for the answer to the question of how, we have to point to the mystery of the question and ask who. I mean, the 20th century started with the discovery of blood types. And just recently, we've been able to create a whole new human heart for transplant using a 3D printer and the cells from the patient in which the heart will go into. Think about that. Is that what Jesus was talking about? I mean, today we all carry computers in our pocket, right? A few years ago, I was talking to Debbie face to face while she was in South Korea and I was driving down the highway in Florida. That just is me. I can even call her with my watch, which for some of you that are younger, that's probably not a big deal. But for me and my age, that's like Dick Tracy stuff right there, man. These are just a very few of the advances of just the past 100 years or so. I mean, think about this. The year that my mother was born, that was the first year that women in this country were allowed to vote. Allowed to vote. Y'all know who Elizabeth Platts is? Probably not. She was the first female Lutheran pastor ordained in the United States. It was 1970. Today, there are hundreds of female pastors, and there are 33 female synodical bishops, and our presiding bishop of our church is Elizabeth Eaton. Is this what Jesus was talking about? I could spend all day doing this, by the way. I mean, how many of you have been treated for something that 50 or 70 years ago would have been your death warrant? And yet here you are, stumbling through life on your way to a happy destiny. How many of you have had cataracts removed and now can see, or have gone through chemotherapy and now you feel great? How many of you have had a stent placed in your heart to open a blockage that in the past would have killed you? I mean, think about this. We can push a glass against the refrigerator and ice comes out. I mean, again, that's not a big deal for you and me, but think about those who lived 100 years ago. I could go on. The Constitution, the Bill of Rights, an end to slavery, the Civil Rights Act, polio and smallpox vaccines, the COVID vaccine, marriage equality, electric vehicles. Is this what Jesus meant? Is this what he meant when he told his disciples that there's a lot more that you need to know, but you just can't bear that now? But the Holy Spirit, the advocate, will come and speak to you the truth, a truth that comes from the Father and through the Son, and will be revealed to you by the Spirit of Christ in you. Is that what Jesus meant? Is that what Jesus meant? And if so, what will be next? What truth about the world or about us? That thing that we need to know that changes our perspective and then changes how we treat one another or the world around us. What is it that God, in and through Jesus Christ, and by God's Spirit in the world in us, is going to reveal to you, or maybe about you? What will it be? And will it make a difference? Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. As you're able, please stand. We'll continue with our worship. ice comes out. The scriptures tell us that if we believe we are without sin, we're lying to ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so we join our voices together and we confess our sin, saying, Lord, you loved us with your life and promised your presence always. By your Spirit, forgive us for our self-centeredness, for placing our desire before you, for judging those who are different, for allowing fear of what we don't know or understand to rule our hearts. Help us to become who you made us to be mindful of our words and actions, remembering that you created in your image. Forgive us, and by your Spirit, redeem us, in and through Christ. Amen. Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sin. As a called and ordained minister in the Church of Jesus Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sin. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We take a few moments to greet each other with signs of peace. There is a Cistercian monk, a Trappist monk, by the name of Richard Rohr, and he has become over the years kind of a great. He operates a place in New Mexico, and I know that he's at the end of his life. Anyway, I've read a number of the books that he's written. The last one that I really enjoyed is called Universal Christ. And it gives us an understanding of how Christ actually is in the world, and that usually it's in you. So at this time, we're going to receive our offering, and we're going to take a listen to this.
Just like the very first moment, when time and space exploded into being, my life, just as it is right now, is a perfect expression of divine love.
Every dark night, every sunrise, every back step, every happiness.
like the stars, the moon, the earth, the trees,
the oceans,
the creatures and all human beings, past, present, and future.
Everything visible without exception.
Everything visible without exception is the outpouring of God.
The first cries of a newborn.
Skyscrapers at night. The memory of a kiss.
Blooming wildflowers after a forest fire.
A cup of coffee, rice and beans.
The quiet hum of a washing machine.
Dancing barefoot.
Patterns on the wings of butterflies.
The gifts of healing passed down from my ancestors.
The sound of a drum and the hands that strike it.
In all of creation, there is a unifying heartbeat.
One word for it is Christ.
One word for it is Christ. One word for it is Christ.
It includes everyone.
It excludes no one.
Christ is not Jesus' last name, but the blueprint for all of reality.
For the Big Bang and everything after.
Christ is wherever ordinary matter and spirit meet.
Christ is wherever the divine unites with the human.
Jesus broke bread and said, "This is my body." He lifted a cup and said, "My blood."
God loves things by becoming them.
By taking on physicality, flesh, tears, blood. The body of Christ is not somewhere out there. It's in you. It's in me.
It's in me. It's in me.
It's in me.
It's in me.
It's in me. Here and now.
Christ in a high school student afraid to go back to school.
Christ in the heart of a woman marching for change.
Christ in the gay couple searching for a church.
Christ in the inmate alone in her cell.
Christ in the immigrant family waiting under a blue tarp. Christ in the soldier a long way from home.
Christ in the one who hears voices diagnosed with mental illness. Christ in the single mother-to-be.
Christ in the black father teaching his young son about race.
Christ in whatever holds quarks together.
To be a Christian.
To be a Christian.
To be one with Christ.
To be a Christian is to see Christ in everything. In every thing.
In every thing.
Had you able, please stand. Please pray with me. Oh God, we know that all that we have, all that we are, is first from you. Use these things that we offer, signs of our love and faithfulness, to continue to grow your kingdom, to reveal your kingdom to those who seek you. And use us for the same. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Just give me a minute here. I'm back here. The Lord be with you. Fulfilling the promise of the resurrection, you pour the fire of your spirit, uniting in one body of people, in every nation and every tongue, your love. You, holy God, you formed the earth from chaos. You encircled the globe with air. You created fire for warmth and light. You nourished the lands with water. You molded us in your image, and with mercy higher than the mountains, with grace deeper than the seas, you blessed your people and cherished them as your own, that also we might know freedom from the power of sin and death, that we might live in your spirit and your spirit in us. And so as we gather around your table, we recall that on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink, all of you. This cup is the new covenant, the new relationship in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Holy God, merciful and compassionate one, send upon this meal your Holy Spirit, whose breath fills us with life and whose fire rouses us to love. Enfold us in your arms and all those who will share this holy food. Nurture us in the fruits of the Spirit that we may be a living tree, sharing your bounty with all of the world. All glory and honor is yours, O Holy Living One. O God, with the Holy Spirit in your church now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. These are the gifts of God, given for you, the people of God, and all are invited. Thanks be to God. As we receive the sacrament this morning, it'd probably be best if we just fill up the front part of this side instead of trying to get around to the back, because I don't want to knock anything over or start a fire. As you're able, please be seated.
of eyes unveiled, we will see your throne. Jesus, Prince of Peace, Son of God, Emmanuel. Glory to the King of Peace, Majesty.
Receive this blessing. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Please pray with me. Give you thanks, O God, for this gift of life that you give to us. These common things, bread and wine, and yet through faith in you, your true presence in us, Christ in us, use us to share this good news with those who are alone, those who seek you, those who live in turmoil and grief. Use it to nurture us so that we might share this good news in great joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We want to thank those of you who are watching online and ask you to continue to do so. We promise that the technology is going to get a little bit better here shortly. In the meantime, we'd like you to like us on Facebook and subscribe on YouTube. Also, if you're watching online, we encourage you to continue to give your offering. You can do that by pressing the green button that comes in your weekly update or on your Wednesday reminder, as well as on the Give drop-down menu on our website. That said, tomorrow is Vacation Bible School. Or I think, is it tomorrow or is it Tuesday? It's tomorrow, yeah. So we also are still looking for those. We're still looking for employees, those who have a desire to make a difference in children's lives. We've been working on our wages, and there's a hiring bonus, so please apply and do that by calling that number or give us a call. We'll make sure that you get in to see the right people, or if you know somebody. Anybody got a birthday today? All right. Okay. That's it, huh? That's all you got? That's all I got. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. As you're able, please stand and we'll send ourselves out of here.
Therefore, to every nation, preach the gospel in every land, every language and every people. In my name, reach out your hand. Tell the world the message, take it anywhere. Every tribe and nation, we are called to share. Tell the world the message, take it anywhere. Every tribe and nation, we are called to share. Go ye therefore to every neighbor, share my love with every man. The world will know that you are mine. In my name, you reach out your hand. Tell the world the message. Every tribe and nation, we are called to share. Tell the world the message, take it everywhere. Every tribe and nation, we are called to share.
So I was just told to think of someone like maybe Kim Applewhite. She's a wife and a mother and a person. Is that what you said?
A mother, a daughter, and a teacher.
A mother, a daughter, and a teacher. So you just took my $20. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.